Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the third video in the STM32 UART series, and today we will start receiving the data. In today's video we will see how to receive the data in the blocking mode, and using the interrupt. We will also see what are the advantages and disadvantages of using the same. Then we will cover the receiving using the DMA in the next video. I will continue using the project from the previous video, and here it is. We need to make some changes in the CubeMX, so let's open the IOC file. Let's disable the DMA as we are not using it to transfer the data today. We will leave the interrupt enabled as we will use the interrupt to receive the data. The rest of the setup will remain as it is, so click Save to update the project. Let me delete the extra code from the previous video. Let's define a new buffer RX data where we will store the data received by the UART. In the while loop we will leave the LED blinking as we are going to monitor it also. Alright, so we will start with the blocking mode first. HolUARTReceive function receives the data in the blocking mode. The parameters are the UART instance, the buffer where the data will be stored, the data size to be received, and the timeout. The timeout plays an important role, as this function will only wait for this time period. Here I am setting it to 1 second, and if the 5 bytes data is not received within 1 second, the function will timeout. Let's set the LED blinking to every 1 second. Alright, let's build and test it. I will use the same serial monitor to send the data from the computer. We are using the same configuration, so let's connect to the virtual COM port. Let me add the buffer to the live expression. We should see the data under this value section. Let's run the code now. Here I am sending the work, hello, but I did not receive it. This is probably because the function timed out, and the MCU was only able to receive the first byte. Then the CPU toggles the LED, and waits for 1 second. If the data is sent within this time, it will be lost. Basically, the data needs to arrive at exactly the same time when the control enters the UARTReceive function, and the required data needs to arrive within the timeout. Let me show this. I will run the debugger and quickly send the 5 bytes data. I sent the data before 1 second, and the MCU received it quite well. But this is very unlikely to happen in the real scenario. Another option is that we increase the waiting time. Here I am setting the timeout to infinity, the CPU will wait forever until all 5 data bytes have been received. Let's test this. You can see the LED on board is not blinking, and this is because the control does not come out of the receive function. Now let's send 1 byte at a time. Here we are receiving the data in the buffer, but the control still doesn't come out, as it is looking for 5 bytes in total. Once all the 5 bytes have been received, the control finally comes out of the receive function, and the rest of the while loop executes. We can send all 5 bytes at once and the control will exit the function immediately. This is how the blocking mode works. The CPU will be blocked for a certain duration, and will be released only when either all the data bytes have been received, or if the timeout occurs. You might think that this is a completely useless mode to receive the data, but that is not true. If you are using RTOS, you can create a separate task, and use this mode to receive a single data byte. Then store those data bytes in the main buffer, and get yourself the complete data. This reduces unnecessary interrupts in the RTOS application. I am not using RTOS in today's video, but I will show how to store single data bytes in the main buffer, but using the interrupt. So we saw how to receive data in blocking mode. Without RTOS, it certainly is not a reliable method to receive the data. This is where the interrupt comes in. HolUART receive IT takes the parameter as the UART instance, the buffer, and the number of bytes to be received. Again, we need to know how many data bytes are coming. The interrupt will not trigger until the required number of bytes have been received. But the advantage is that the CPU is not blocked during the wait. The rest of the code can execute as usual. Once the required number of bytes have been received, the interrupt will trigger, and the RxComplete callback will be called. We can process the data inside this callback. I am not going to process the data for now, so let's leave it. The interrupt is disabled after each call, so we need to enable it again in the callback function. Let's build and debug the project. Run the debugger now. You can see the LED is blinking every 1 second, so the CPU is handling the rest of the tasks as usual. I am sending one byte at a time, but the interrupt will only execute once it has received all 5 data bytes. This is the 5th byte, and here you can see the breakpoint got hit in the callback function. Here it got hit again after receiving 5 new bytes. So we are able to receive the data, and the CPU can process other tasks as well. There is one major issue here: we can only receive the data of fixed length. This won't work well for the data of random sizes. So we will modify this code a little. Let's define another array of 1 or 2 bytes. Now we will receive only 1 data byte via the UART. Once the UART received 1 byte, the callback will be called, and here we will store this byte in our main buffer. Let's define an index variable to keep track of how many bytes have been received in total. The index will also be used to store the new data at a new position in the buffer. Inside the callback, store the received data byte in the RX data array. Now increment the index variable, and if its value is 20 or more, reset it to 0. This is because our RX data array can only store 20 bytes at max. Include the string header file for the memcopy function to work. Alright, let's build and debug the project. Now we can send as many data bytes as we want. The new data will always be stored at a new position in the RX buffer. Note that the buffer does not have enough space for this data, so the data should overlap from the beginning. Here you can see it overlapped the previously stored data from the beginning. Although the space between what and is missing. This is probably due to this line here. Let me send another set of data to confirm this. The last byte, 4, is missing. It should have been stored at the beginning of the buffer. We need to first increment the index variable, and then check the condition. Let's build and debug again. Alright, let's test it now. We have only 2 bytes space remaining, so the overlap should happen now. The last 2 bytes will be 1, and 2, and the 3 should be stored at the beginning of the buffer. Alright, it works fine now. So we were able to receive the data with unknown length. This will work fine for certain types of communications, but keep in mind we still don't know the length of incoming data. I mean, it is very hard to find how many data bytes arrived at a certain point of time. HOL actually provides a dedicated function for it, and we will cover it in the next tutorial. Anyway, we can still check some conditions to know if the expected data have arrived or not. Say for example, I know that the incoming data has a terminating new line character. Also, I want to store my final data in a separate buffer. So we will check for that particular character in the incoming data. Actually, let's do this in the while loop. If the character has received, this means we have received the required data, so we will copy the data from the RX data buffer to the final data buffer. The length will be the same as the value of the index variable. Now reset the index to 0, so that the data storage in the RX data buffer can start from the beginning again. Let's build and debug the code now. This checkbox is used to add the new line character to the end of the data. Let's first send the data without it. So we are receiving the data in the RX data buffer. Let me add the final data buffer to the live expression. You can see there is nothing in it. Now I am adding the terminating character to the data, indicating this is all I want to send. And here you can see, all the data from the start has been stored in the final data buffer. See, I hope you understood how this works. There are limitless possibilities here, and you can write the code according to what you expect to receive. This method still has some drawbacks, as things might get complicated when you are receiving a large amount of data at a very high rate. Remember that the interrupt is being triggered for each byte, and by the time the interrupt is served, the callback is called, and the interrupt is called again, we might lose one or two data bytes. We have other methods as well to handle the unknown data lengths, and we will cover them in the upcoming tutorials. This is it for the video. You can download the code from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching and have a nice day ahead.